herbaria and natural history museums in general are really one of the best places to study and understand nature, at least across space and time. We're in a moment of major change, and these changes are related to human use of the landscape and climate change. These have an impact on organisms, and some research that we're doing is already kind of identifying the kind of winners and losers, at least in terms of climate change response.
This is a beautiful rhododendron from this part of the world, from New England. Rhododendron canadensis is the name. And you can see that these plants are indeed flattened and dried. This plant was actually flowering at the time it was collected. So here you can see the flowers and the young emerging leaves are over here. And then importantly, on the label, you have the key information for the specimen. So you've got the species name, Rhododendron canadensis, right here. You've got information about its locality. It was collected in Bloomfield in Essex County in Vermont. And it was collected from a bog. So you have some habitat information as well. It likes its feet wet. And then you have the date of the collection, June 12th, 1932, and also who collected the plant. And then additionally, you'll see that we have this barcode, and this barcode is linked to a database entry that contains all of this collection information, and it also captures an image of this species. So you can go online right now using this barcode, or indeed using this information here on the specimen, and you can find this species online. Here we have a collection of the same species collected from Essex County, again in Vermont, around a boggy area. And in this case, it was collected May 17th, 1982. So earlier in the year, about a month earlier. And what you see is that this plant has already passed flower, and it's actually in fruit. So these structures here are fruits. So in May, much earlier in the season, you've got flowering is already passed and the fruits are developed than compared to the specimen from 1932, where this is very much still in flower and you see no evidence of fruits yet produced. These things here are actually the young leaves and not actually the fruits.
Okay, so we have two new species for our list here, both wetland.
Kind of a prominent aspect of building a collection is to have researchers traveling out to their respective field sites and build the collections. And one that's of interest and relevance is Henry David Thoreau. Thoreau in the 1850s was traveling far and wide across Concord, just west of Boston, to collect yet another early flowering event. But even before then, he was learning the identity of these species, and to facilitate his learning, he was actually making his own collection that was stored in his house. We actually have his collection here as part of our collection now in the herbaria, but they were crucial in his understanding and learning the flora. Thoreau was gathering not only these collections, but also taking detailed notes about these transitional events in nature. In particular, he was interested in when plants were flowering and when birds were arriving into the area during the early spring. And so he was documenting these observations in his journals, and he basically took these observations over a period of about a decade. And in order to understand how organisms respond to climate, you need a long time horizon. You need many, many years of information and data. Fortunately for us, there were many researchers along the way that were also gathering similar kinds of information during different periods in time. In the early 1900s, an amateur naturalist by the name of Alfred Hosmer collected information over a period of about 15 years. And then more recently, myself and colleagues collected in 2010 onward of flowering times and their abundances during the present day. So here we have sort of a snapshot of 30 years worth of information of flowering time changes across this time when we've had dramatic changes in temperature over this period on the order of about 2 degrees Celsius during that period in time. And so what we did was to start to do experiments where we compared flowering time observations as extracted from these herbarium collections with those gathered by Thoreau and Hosmer and others who were documenting these directly through time. And what we found was really powerful and unexpected, which is that climate change is not impacting communities of plants in a random or uniform way. Instead, what we found in New England is in fact that certain lineages or groups through common descent were exhibiting similar responses. Things like orchids and lilies that were responding less dynamically to climate were the groups of organisms that were across the board becoming more rare in these areas when they were once relatively common. You know, on average, about 60% of the plant species that Thoreau documented and recorded around Concord, you can no longer find there today, or they're so rare that you have to know a botanist to show you where to find them. And so putting a more concrete perspective on those kind of changes is really enlightening for thinking about the kinds of ways in which climate change is shaping plant diversity in particular. Now is the exciting part, where you get to wrestle with some of the data and make your own observations about how plants respond to climate in particular, and hopefully this will really allow you to appreciate the value and the richness of these priceless collections here at Harvard and more broadly.